Mazel tov. Mazel tov. And now, let's eat. And don't be shy. Use your fingers. Alisa Kuka and her husband Leon were married in Cairo in 1937. After Nasser came to power, the Kuka family emigrated to the United States and settled in Miami. Alisa is famous for her stuffed grape leaves, a perfect finger food for any celebration. Her daughter Juliet joined us in the kitchen. Alisa and Juliet, it's wonderful to see you again.
Me too. Thank you, Joan.
My pleasure.
Today we're going to make Egyptian grape leaves, stuffed grape leaves.
Wonderful.
You're going to show me how to do them?
Very easy.
Okay, let's go. Okay.
Actually, this is her specialty, and as you know, Joan, there are many variations of stuffed grape leaves. This is the not only the Egyptian version, but it is the Sephardic Jewish version.
Okay, great.
And the way my mother makes it is really the best.
All right. Tell me what you put in the filling, first of all.
I take, to start with, 1 cup of rice, uh-huh. Wash it good, and mix with the ground beef, kosher, of course. And I put 1/2 can, 4 ounces, tomato juice, and 1 tablespoon of oil, and salt and pepper.
And that's
and
it,
garlic.
Right? Oh yeah, garlic is always
important.
Few
garlic, I squeeze it in to mix with the meat.
And then you take about 2 tablespoons in your fingers, right?
Yeah, whatever the size of the grape leaves. Some grape leaves are large, some are smaller.
And these are canned grape leaves, right?
They come in a jar.
And then what do you wash them in water before
Absolutely,
you use them?
Absolutely, yes.
And I noticed that you put them the shiny side down and the rough side up.
No problem.
Yeah,
for
I don't
me.
Think it makes
it doesn't
a difference.
Matter.
No,
right?
It doesn't matter.
Right. As long as you have the stem part against you, then it becomes much
And you,
you know,
turn
much easier.
It, turn it until you make like a finger.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Goes by
when
quick.
You were growing up, who made the grape leaves when you were doing this? I guess we should
my
really
grandmother.
Start working with her.
Yeah.
My grandmother.
Right.
She used to make
You know, I really
lot.
Should learn how to do that quickly the way she does
she
it.
She never
so quickly.
Made. Mommy, no. We have company.
I want
Please
you to make.
Make me grape leaves. All her friends are doctors. They tell Juliet, if they don't make the grape leaves, I'm not coming.
We're not coming.
If you had a lot of people over, you would always make something like
this. Yeah, but not only this.
Yeah, and
need
other
extra
dishes.
Food.
What else did you make?
This is like a snack, you know. They
I
eat
guess,
it
yeah.
cold, they eat it hot.
Right.
It's delicious. And sometimes we make all vegetable, no meat.
You grew up in Cairo. Now, I know there's a story about you and the pyramids. I want to hear that story. Tell me about that story.
My story is, one night, it was Saturday night, I was coming from work.
Yeah.
And I see 3 big buses at the entrance of our house. I said, what happened? What's going on? They said, this short man.
That was my father.
With the glasses, he's the one who, Who is the one who organized the party?
Oh, right? He organized
and he
a trip,
men, girls
an excursion.
And boy, excursion to go to the pyramid.
Uh-huh.
I said, oh my God, I never saw the pyramid. I was very young when my father died. It was different life.
Right.
So I looked inside the bus. I saw my brother there. I had a brother 2.5 years older.
Yeah.
I said, oh my God, where he got the money? Uh-huh. In that time, it was 50 cents. 50 cents today is different. I said, how? And then I ran over my mom. I told her, I want to go to the pyramid like my brother.
Right.
She said, but we don't have no money. Enough, your brother. We don't have for you. I was very, very upset and jealous. I ran back and I said, who is the one who organized the party?
Yeah.
They told me this man with the glasses, the short man. I went to him. I said, Mister, can I go in? My brother is there. I was only 14.
So he took a look at her and he liked
her. He told me, tell me number one, what's your name?
Number one, two, and three, right?
Yeah. I said, my name is Lisa Antebi. I said, here is my brother inside. But he told me it's 50 cents. I said, I pay you later.
And she did. And you never had to
and
pay.
And he let me get in.
Ma, I wanted to ask you, sometimes I see you squeezing after you roll the grape leaf, you squeeze it.
Yeah.
Do you always do that or
no?
Only if it feels wet?
Yeah, it's too soft.
Yeah.
I squeeze it a little bit, but it's not good to squeeze it too much.
I guess you have to leave enough moisture for the rice to expand.
The rice.
So you can't do it too tight.
No.
Right.
But you have to have it firmly done, because otherwise it's too loose.
Like that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
All right, so we've done, how many have we done
probably
here?
Probably about 40, I would say.
I can't believe it.
Tell me what you're going
to
do.
We have to steam it for 5 to 10 minutes.
Covered.
Right. And then we're going to put the juice.
Great.
The lemon juice, the lemon with tomato sauce, salt and pepper, and that's it.
And then you're going to steam it some more?
No, no steam. The rice has to be done with the tomato sauce. Now I put the juice.
I see. Okay. Whoa,
that looks yummy.
And that's it. You leave it for 10 to 15 minutes until the rice been absorbed by the juice. And that's it. If you like, you can test it. Everybody can test it.
Everybody can. Good.
That's right.
Okay, let's
try it.
All right, let's go.
Ooh. Wow, look at that. Rice one by one. No rice come out from the grape leaf.
Oh, that's
yes,
good.
I like
so
it.
We did a good job for you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, why don't we...
No, don't destroy it.
Okay, you did. Mom.
All right.
Okay. Because her children,
they grab.
And this is the same way you would stuff eggplant or zucchini, tomatoes.
Can we taste this? Okay, Joan.
Okay. Okay. Mmm.
Delicious.
Mm.
I like the marriage of tomato, garlic,
and lemon.
And rice.
Thank you so much.
Fish cakes make for great finger food. Ann Rosenzweig's salmon cakes are something really special. Ann, one of New York's finest chefs, serves her salmon cakes as a main course.
My grandmother was a very wonderful cook. I grew up hearing all about her and her wonderful recipes. And so we think there's a genetic connection between her and I, and I think it skipped my mother. but I certainly grew up hearing all about these wonderful recipes and how wonderful food was and how terrific food, the place that food held in everybody's heart in the family.
Like salmon cakes
like
for
salmon
Thursday
cakes.
Night dinner.
Right. We used to have salmon cakes all the time. We do it with fresh salmon. At home we used to do it with canned salmon because canned salmon was sort of the cat's meow back then when I was a kid. So what we did is we poached some salmon.
Right, the way
and,
you've done it.
And we're just going to flake it up. You want to cook it so it's still very moist, and even if it's a little bit undercooked, that's just fine because we're going to cook these salmon cakes again.
Okay. All right,
and
so you flake this.
We flake that. And now we're going to add a little bit of breadcrumbs. These are fresh brioche breadcrumbs. You can use any kind of...
You could use leftover challah, too, right?
You could use leftover challah would be perfect. Then we're going to put in some eggs. Well, I think the great thing about any kind of fish cakes is people really love them. They feel very at home with them, and there's so many different things that you can put in them. Sometimes when we make fish cakes at the restaurant, we'll put in old mashed potato or old baked potato, lots of different sautéed vegetables like peppers and onions and things like that. And almost anything you put into a fish cake is very delicious.
Okay,
we're going to add some chopped chives.
Mm-hmm.
And some chopped parsley, because I love the flavor of fresh herbs.
Again, the green makes a beautiful color, right, which is something that I'm sure your grandparents in Russia never had.
Probably not. And some Dijon mustard. And then we have some shallots diced very fine, and some tomatoes diced very fine.
Do you peel the tomatoes?
I don't. I cut them and I seed them, but I leave the skin on.
Okay.
Because I think cooking at home shouldn't take hours and hours. So we mix that all together.
That looks beautiful.
And if you want, one of the things you can do to make sure that it's seasoned how you want it, I like them mustardy, but if you like it less so, you can always take a little cake and sauté it in a pan, fry it up in advance so you know exactly what they're going to taste like. There won't be any surprises.
This is probably one of the oldest dishes, not in this form. A fish cake really is what you can do either with leftover fish or a way to stretch fish. And in a sense, gefilte fish is similar to this in that it's a way of stretching the fish. And something that you can eat cold the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Not as elegant, but.
Right, makes a great sandwich.
Okay,
I'm going to add a little bit more breadcrumb. Slightly tighter consistency. And then what we're going to do is we take some more breadcrumbs, and you can add in a little bit of dry mustard.
Okay.
If you want to leave that out, you could.
Mix it up.
Mix
Hope
that
this
up.
Is enough.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Use a fork to mix. It'll be a little bit better.
What we're going to do is we're going to take the salmon, form it into a cake. One of the nice things about having all these tomatoes and shallots and herbs in it is it keeps the cake very, very moist. So you just want it to just hold together. And we put it in there. And then, since your hands are dry,
just roll it.
You can just roll it.
So you coat it with the.
Coat it with the crumbs. And these could be made in advance if you wanted to. One of the nice things is when you're making a fish cake, if you make it and crumb it and then put it in your refrigerator,
then you could just
overnight, is the crumb gets even tighter.
And it's easier to fry.
And it's easier to saute or fry.
And see how firm those salmon cakes are for being in the refrigerator? I can see why you do that. It's going to be much easier to fry them.
Right. So we're going to have a hot pan. I'm just going to add a little bit of oil. You don't need too much, especially if you use.
What kind of oil do you use?
This is just a little safflower. I use some kind of vegetable oil, or you can use a very light olive oil if you want. And it'll get hot very quickly. And sometimes I do this, if I have a lot of cakes and I don't have a pan big enough, I do this in the oven. And you can just do it on a big sheet tray.
Right.
You can bake it and then flip it. Okay. What's nice about having the breadcrumbs on the outside is you have a little bit of contrast between the textures. The inside is sort of kind of creamy and soft, and the outside will be a little bit crisp, and you get a nice little burn from the mustard, the dry mustard.
Okay. Wonderful. I see it already browning up there.
Altogether, it takes about 5 to 7 minutes, and I think it's almost ready now.
And what are you going to serve the salmon cakes with?
I like sometimes to serve a little ragu of lentils and tomatoes and parsley.
Lentils is a very biblical dish.
It's a nice sort of humble bed for these beautiful salmon cakes.
Let's serve it up then.
Okay.
So this really goes very well together.
And that's the dish, and I can just see garnishing it maybe with a little bit of baby greens or a little bit of fresh dill sprigs.
Oh, what a good idea. Right in the middle. Looks
right in
beautiful.
The middle.
A knish is a Jewish dumpling, often filled with cheese or potatoes. One of California's superstar chefs, Gary Danko, makes a light potato knish, just the way I really like them.
Gary, I know you've been the best chef of California for the James Beard. You've won that award. But have you made knishes before?
Actually, I have made knishes, and I've actually cooked Passover dinner. So. Ideally, you know, I grew up in upstate New York, and my father was born of Hungarian parents, and, you know, my grandmother was Jewish. One thing they never wanted to talk about is where they came from, so I know very little about her, but I do know there were a lot of women that came into our household and cooked a lot of Hungarian with slight Jewish overtones, so. Anyhow, We're going to make some potato knishes today, and there's a few components. First of all, we're going to make the dough. It's basically a strudel dough. Mm-hmm. You know, ideally, this came from sort of humble beginnings, very humble ingredients that were made to taste delicious. So this is what we're going to make, is basically a strudel dough. And I have 4 eggs here, and I'm going to put about 1/4 teaspoon of salt, just kosher salt. And then we're going to put in 1/2 cup of oil. And I'm just going to slowly beat this. This is basically the same technique you would use in making pasta, except for you wouldn't put that oil in there. Some places would. And then we're going to start beating in the flour here. And you just want to start very slowly. And it takes a little while to do this. And then slowly bring it in from the sides. You can also do this in a food processor if you want. Just put your eggs and oil and salt in there and then whisk it in and then knead it. But it's always nice to do traditional methods. I think it's one way to learn what things should taste like. And a big thing in cooking is texture. So you just want to keep mixing this around.
I like the way you swirl
and mixing and mixing. So you can see it's starting to get a little clumpier here. You want to put a little more flour in here. And then just mix it until you actually feel you can mix it, pour it onto the counter. We are going to develop the gluten in this dough. And that's when it's going to allow you to stretch this. Traditionally, strudel was kneaded, and then you stretch it over very, very thin, so thin that you should be able to read a paper for it. This is actually a little coarser recipe here, and it's going to be a little thicker dough, but it's going to be a delicious one. So just going to knead this, and this will take approximately up to 4 cups of flour. Again, no 2 flours are the same in any country or any state, so you basically want to get this to a very elastic stage. And as I knead it, I'm going to pull it in here. We're just going to let this rest. You want to cover it. You can see it's very developed in gluten. You can see it's springing back. And this is because I've developed all that gluten. We're just going to let this rest, and then I'm going to show you how to make the filling here. So.
Okay.
Okay, so what we have right here is some sauteed onions. This is about 4 large onions. And I just took a little bit of vegetable oil. And you want to sweat these for about 20 minutes. So meanwhile, we're going to take some potatoes. And these are russet potatoes, just boiled in water until fork tender. You know, basically just go in like this. Russets are very important in this because they're very starchy potatoes, and they do better when you're going to bake them. What we want to do is take these and mash them, and we're just going to put them right into this bowl here. These have cooled about 5 minutes, so I'm going to put the onion in here, and then we're going to put just 1 egg in there, and that's going to bind it. So when you bake it, it's going to firm it up a little, and we're going to put some parsley. It's about 1/2 cup of a chopped Italian parsley, which is very flavorful.
Absolutely.
Okay, we're just going to put this on top of here. And then just either with your hands or with a masher, depending on how hot it is, it's a very textural feeling to go in here with your hands, but this is a little hot. So all you want to do is just mix this up. Again, not destroying all of the texture, leaving some chunks here. And of course, you want to taste it for salt. I'm a big believer in salt. That salt, in properly used in food, will actually help satisfy your hunger and actually will stop people from eating as much. So basically, we have our filling here right now. And I'm just going to set this aside to cool. And then actually, we can start rolling out the dough. I have some that I have rested.
I'm going to take some of this. Mm, good.
Is it good?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Listen. I never met a person who didn't like a potato knish. There's something about potatoes. Is it comfort food wrapped in pastry?
It's everything. It's the flavor. Actually, I think these are going to be in vogue again as hors d'oeuvres and cocktail parties because people love this type of eating. Anyway, we're going to show you how to roll the dough. This is 1/4 of the amount because the other would be huge for this counter space. So basically, we're going to start rolling, and we want to get this into about a 14-inch length and about 5 inches wide. Normally, when you want to widen pastry, you go at an angle like this. Instead of pushing it out like this. So same thing, you want to get it down like this, you would angle it like this. So again, this is going to be a dough that is going to stretch.
And stretch and stretch.
And stretch. So if we wanted to, if we had the time, we could get it out so we could read the newspaper through it. But I'm going to get it to a point where we can, excuse my elbows here.
It's okay.
So what we're going to do is just sort of pull this. You can see we can get this out really big if you want. Again, we want to get it enough to get a nice sort of log of this delicious filling in there. But it's one of those things where you can stretch it. This is the gluten. So, okay. You want to help put some filling on there?
Okay.
By the time you get the filling on, I think we can just give it another stretch and get what we want to. So.
Right.
Again, the texture here is very chunky and those big hunks of caramelized onion. And of course, salt and pepper. So. Right.
And this is not a dainty dish.
Right? This is a substantial dish, but you know, they're very delicious and very easy to do. You could actually make this and freeze it if you'd like, and then bake them that away. Yeah. Or you can bake them and then also freeze them. So, okay, let's just pull this if you want to help me just stretch a little.
Actually, one of the things that I like to do with this is to bake some and then freeze the others unbaked, just the way you said.
That's an efficient way to cook. Okay, we want to roll this up now.
Want me to help you?
Sure, that'd be great. Okay. I'm going to get some oil right here, and we're going to brush just very lightly. Again, there's a little bit of oil in here, and this is when it's cooked. It's going to help brown the pastry and give it a little texture, a little firmness to it. So, okay, so we're just going to keep going. And you can put oil on every occasion, a little piece, and just very... This is getting pretty big here.
And you can actually, I think you can even stretch
it. Yeah, we can stretch it this way if you want.
As long as you want.
Pretend with our pin. But traditionally, we'd sort of roll it out a little if you want to get it longer and that type, so. Okay, you want us, let's show them your method of doing this.
Okay,
and, I think this is very unique, actually.
I learned this from an old Jewish baker. I mean, a knish maker.
Knish maker.
I was giving a class once, and it naturally slices it.
That's great, and it sort of crimps it together, too.
Right.
We have a sheet pan here, so let's... This is basically lightly oiled, and we're just going to set those on. This is great. I learned a new trick today.
I learned some from you, too.
So anyhow, we'll just keep putting these on here. They look like little wontons, kind of like you would get at a dim sum restaurant.
Well, it's possible that this person learned from somebody who made dim sum.
Well, there is that whole thing about pasta and pastry and strudel leaves and who invented them. And
who cooked them, right?
Okay, so we can either brush these with a little bit of this oil or we can do some egg wash on it. Since we have the oil here, we'll just put a little bit on here. I think the egg wash would give it a little more, golden color, but... Uh-huh. See how these come out. Okay, so just gonna pop these in the oven, and these bake at 375, and I think they're gonna go for probably 12 to 15 minutes. So.
All right, we'll see how they taste.
Exactly. Well, I think they're done, Joan. Let's take a peek in here. Oh, look at these. Beautiful.
Oh, great.
Very nice.
Good, good, good.
Okay, perfect. Let's go over here. These look really great. So I'm just gonna move them. These are very, very hot, so.
Wow.
Come on, you've got those fingers.
Yeah, right. Very hot. Okay.
Okay, so these are really good. Let's break knish together.
Break knish. Should we say a knish prayer?
Okay, here's one. These are beautiful looking.
Oh, wow.
Smell the pepper and the onions.
Mm.
Excellent. Very good.
We should take l'chaim to knish. Great.
To learn more about Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan, visit us online at www.pbs.org. Companion products for Jewish cooking in America, including Joan Nathan's updated cookbook, a CD of the music score, and a two-hour video of series highlights and recipes, are available by calling 1-800-235-3000. Credit cards are accepted. Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan is made possible by the Joseph S. and Diane H. Steinberg Charitable Trust, proud supporters of the arts, children's causes, and the preservation of Jewish heritage. And by Hebrew National, proud sponsors of Jewish cooking in America, serving you and your family traditional kosher franks and delicatessen products since 1905. Hebrew National, we answer to a higher authority.
And by Lender's Bagels. Our idea of a perfect day is warm and comforting and satisfying all around. Lender's Bagels, the perfect circle.
And by the following private individuals and family foundations. This has been a co-production of Joan Nathan, Frappe Productions, and Maryland Public Television.
This is PBS.